No.
You should have said, you should have seen what she did yesterday when we were doing our practice.
Not my fault.
The internet, the woman, she went to her phone, she pulled it up on her phone, she plugged the earplug jack into her phone, and put it over the system, and it worked perfectly.
Not sure I could figure that out.
I don't think so either.
She'll figure something out for the invitation, I'm sure.
We have another one to do, right, Char?
Yeah.
Okay, we're gonna do it.
Matthew, chapter seven. That's where we're gonna be looking this morning. Matthew, chapter seven, begin with verse seven. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and to him who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it will be opened. For what man is there among you, if his son asks for bread, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Therefore, whatever you want men to do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. Let's go ahead and go to our Lord. Our Father, as we come to you in the name of Christ, we just ask that you be with us, Lord, that you would guide us, Lord, that you'd be able to take this and apply it to our lives this morning. Lord, we just ask that you would help us to see what you have for us. For we ask these things in your name. Amen. Prayer. As you think about prayer, sometimes we make rather light of it. Sometimes we don't understand just what prayer is and just how important prayer is and just what it is that is actually going on when we pray. Christ tells us if we abide in him and his word abides in us, then we shall ask what we will in his name and it shall be given unto us. Think about that for a moment. Think about what he is saying there, and we're also going to look at what he's saying here. I want you to look, and it says, ask and it will. Look at that word. I want you to see that word. It's that four-letter word that starts with a W and says something very, very specific. God doesn't say, ask and I might hear you. God doesn't say, ask and I might give it to you. God doesn't say, ask and I might give you an answer. God doesn't say, ask and maybe it's going to happen, or something of that nature. Put that together with what he says in John, and I want you to understand that God is listening to what we are saying. God is listening to what we are asking. And God is saying, if you are abiding in me, my word is abiding in you, and you're going to ask something, I'm going to pay attention to what that is.
Praise God.
Now, I want you to notice some more of that verse. Ask, and it will be what? Now, I'm not preaching a name it and claim it type of thing this morning. But I want you to understand something. God wants us to ask for things. God wants us to ask him for things in our lives. God wants us to be involved enough in various things to present that request to him. I've heard people say this. You have to ask for something three times because Christ asked in the garden three times. And you have to ask three times because Paul asked God three times to remove that thorn in the flesh from him. So we have to ask three times for God to hear us. No, that's not what he said. How many of you have ever asked God for something one time and he's answered that prayer? Yeah. How many of you have been driving down the interstate and you know you're going to crash and you go, God help me. And somehow it doesn't happen.
You see, that's what he's saying. That we need to come before God and honestly ask him to do something for us. There's a parable that he gives of the wicked governor. Now, I'm not referring to any particular governor in that aspect, so we just need to understand that this is a wicked governor, and this person keeps coming to that governor and keeps presenting this request to that governor, and she keeps bringing it to him and keeps bringing it to him, and finally that wicked governor says, I'm going to give this lady what she wants because she keeps bothering me with this request, and I don't want her to bother me anymore. And he goes on to say, if the wicked can honor those type of requests, what about our God? What about our Lord? What about the one that says he loves us and he cares for us and he wants to be involved in our lives? I like what he says, ask. James, he says, you have not because you ask not. I like that verse. He goes on to also say, you ask amiss. You know, asking amiss is to keep it upon myself and asking for things from, you know, all these other things that are wrong. But it's a very, very simple point. Why don't you have whatever it is that God wants? Because you haven't asked. Because you haven't said, God, I want to put it before you. I like the next one. No, same verse, Shark. Seek, and you will find. Cheryl's not here. One of her dogs is very, very sick. I don't think that the dog's going to make it. But there are times that I start looking for something. And I'm looking for it, and I'm looking for it, and I can't find it. And Cheryl will say, what are you looking for? And I will tell her what I'm looking for, and she will walk right over to where I just looked and pick it up and say, here it is. Now, I thought I was seeking. I thought I was looking. I thought I was actually being involved in trying to find what it was that I was looking for. But I didn't see it. Seeking means that it is something that I need, I'm looking for, I have to have it type of idea. It's usually the car keys or something like that that I'm looking for and have to have it right away, and it's not there. That's the picture of God. We begin to look for something. We begin to seek for something. We begin to try to find it on our own. And we're trying to get it there. We're trying to locate it. And God says, what are you looking for? Here it is. I want you to notice the same answer is with seek as it is with ask. What's going to happen when we seek and we turn to God looking for that answer? I like what he says. You will find. The other day, the county sheriff went screaming through town. Search and Rescue went screaming through town. And according to their Facebook page, they went up on Smith River Road. And they're looking for somebody up there who jumped out of their truck and ran into the woods. And they were seeking for him. Tom, they got away. They'll find him. They know his name. They know his address. They know where he lives. They'll find him. I thought it was kind of ridiculous. He jumped out of his car and ran away. They know who he is. But, you know, they didn't find him that day. My God knows everything. And when I turn to my God and say, Lord, here is the problem. Here is what I need. This is, I don't know what to do here, whatever it might be. He has the answer. And I like it. He says, you will find. Yeah, same word, isn't it? Will find. It's not you may find or that you might come across it. God says, I'm going to give to you that answer. Prayer, when we think about God,
just that important. I like this next one also, in same verse, Shar. Ask. Or knock, rather. I did ask already. Knock. Have you ever gone to somebody's home and you knocked on the door and you know they're home but they won't answer the door? My mom used to be traveling salesman. And my mom would have us hide because a salesman was coming to the door. And he'd be knocking on the door, looking in the window, and mom's going, shh, shh, be quiet, nobody's home. Nobody else has ever done that, right? Dating myself with traveling salesmen, too. In the Old Testament, there's a story. Elijah on Mount Carmel. And all the prophets of Baal are trying to get God to answer with fire. And I like what he's doing. Cry a little louder. Maybe he's on vacation. Cry a little louder. Maybe he's sleeping. Cry a little louder. He's busy with something else. He's pursuing women. You know, cry a little louder because he's not paying attention to you. We don't have to do that. I've heard people tell me, in order to get God's attention on a particular subject or a particular matter, here is the formula that you have to go through, and this is what you have to do in order to get God's attention. That's the same as Elijah on Mount Carmel talking to the prophets of Baal, saying, this is what you have to do. Cry a little louder. I also like that he just put some water on his offering. He prayed to God, and God answered. But as I look at this, I like what he says. Knock. Come before God and knock and knock and knock. And he says what? He will open.
Amen.
Do you realize what this verse is telling us? Do you realize what this verse is saying? This verse is saying, bring your requests before God. This verse is saying, bring your problems before God. This verse is saying, knock on God, the throne of heaven, to stand before God. Hebrews says it this way, come boldly unto that throne of grace, amen, that you might find mercy to help in time of need.
Amen.
God is saying to us, bring those requests. I want to hear from you. I want to know what's going on. Look at verse 8, Shar. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be open. I want you to notice what he is saying here. God will answer your prayer request.
Amen.
He doesn't say, I might. Now I want you to understand something else. God's answer may be no. What did he tell the Apostle Paul? My grace is sufficient for you. Paul got an answer, didn't he? What did he tell Christ in the garden? That was the answer of no. You're going to the cross. His prayer was, if there's any other way, take this cup from me. And his answer was, no, you're going to the cross. He says, everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, it will be open. I'll tell you something. Just to stay with that second one for just a while. There are times that I come before God and say, God, I have this great idea. And this is what I think it should happen. And I think God just kind of rolls his eyes or whatever it might be because he says something like this. No, here's the better idea. Here's the better thought. Here's the direction you really need to go. Now, did I not get an answer? No. I got an answer. I got a better answer, just as what Jim said. There's a lot of times, but I want you to notice in verse 8, I want you to notice this. If you present a request to God, whether it is by asking, whether it is by seeking, whether it is by knocking, God is going to say something. I will answer that request. So now he goes into verse 9. Mankind, who are we? Well, we're a fallen race. We're a race of sinners. The difference between us here in the church and people who have not accepted Christ is very, very simple. We're forgiven, they're not. You know, that's the biggest difference. We're saved by grace, they need saved by grace. But look what he says. What man is there among you who, if his son asks for bread, will he give him a stone? Dad, I'm hungry. JJ used to do this. We'd pull into my mother-in-law's place and walk in the door and he'd say, how about a sandwich, Grandma? You know what my grandmother would do? Make him a sandwich. What is there among us if a child or son came to us and said, I'm hungry. I need something to eat. How many of you would pick up a stone and hand it to him and say, here, chew on this for a while? Is God going to do that for us? Is God going to say, oh, you want something to eat? Here's a stone? Is God going to reject us so much that he's not going to pay attention to what we are asking? And then he asks this question. Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent? I'm not talking about eating rattlesnake. I don't want to ever try it. But what he's saying, how many of you, if you ask for a fish, are you going to hand him a live snake and say, here, have this instead? You know, there's an old saying that says, if you give a man a fish, you feed him for a day. If you teach him to fish, you've fed him for a lifetime. Have you ever noticed that saying doesn't have, if you give a man a snake, you fed him for a day? If you teach him how to go snaking, you fed him for a lifetime? Mankind, we know the difference between honoring a request and giving it what it requires. How much more does our Heavenly Father? How much more does our God? That's what he's asking here. There were times when JJ would go to the house and say, how about a sandwich, Grandma? And she'd say, well, son, I've got this meal set out on the table already. We were coming over there for a dinner, whatever it might be. And there'd be a whole lot more than just a sandwich. And how much better that was. See, God might look at the request and say, you know, I've got a better answer for you. I've got something greater for you. I've got something more wonderful for you. I've got something that you haven't even imagined yet. But here's the answer. I like what he said to one of the prophets when he said this, be still and know that I am. I will admit there have been times that I have said, God, here's the problem. God, here's the answer. God, let's get it done tomorrow. I'm probably not the only one who's ever done that. You know what the better thing would be? God, here's the problem. I'm waiting for you. Because so often he says, you know, that's not the answer anymore. Look at verse 11. If you then being evil, we don't like to think of us the and that turned blue. You then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more will your Father, who is in heaven, give good things to those who ask him? Every good gift and every perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, with him there is no variableness nor shadow of turning. It's in the book of James, chapter 1. God wants to give to us good gifts. God wants to give to us those gifts because why? He loves us. He cares for us. He wants us to have those things. As I think about prayer and as I think about prayer requests, Sean, go back to that first slide. I want you to think about what he is saying as we think about this. I mean the very first slide, Sean. That slide. Prayer is asking God to do something he would not normally or otherwise do. That's what we're doing. That's what we're bringing before God. That's what we're asking God. We are saying, God, here is something that is bothering me. God, here is something that needs done. God, here is something that I don't know the answer to. God, here is something that is just consuming me. God, I need your help. And we are asking God to do exactly this.
Amen.
Now, that's what prayer is. We are talking to the very one who can change things. We are talking to the one who has the ability to change things. And I like that. I remember there were times when my kids would break something and it would be totally disastrously broke. And they'd say, Dad, fix it. Dad was a marvelous one at fixing it. You know what I would do? I'd go to Walmart and get another one. Here, it's fixed. It took me a couple days, but I got it fixed. My God doesn't need to do that. My God can fix it. My God has the ability. And when they would bring that to me, you see, I may not have done anything about it. I may not even known about it until they brought it to me. Now, God already knows about it. Don't get me wrong. Wants us to bring it to him. God wants us to ask, to seek, to knock. Shar, go back to that verse in Matthew, if you will. I want you to notice we are asking God to do something for us on our behalf. We are coming before the one who has that ability. Oh, it can't be done. That's exactly what God wants us to bring to him. Oh, it's impossible. That's exactly the area that God works in. You see, because with God, what's it say? All things are possible. Prayer. Coming before God and laying it out before him. Ask, seek, knock. Will be answered, will be opened, will be found. Let's go ahead and go to our Lord. Our Father, as we come to you in the name of Christ, Lord, we thank you that you hear us. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that you have that in. Lord, we just love you. And Lord, we just put ourselves before you. Lord, we ask these things in your name. Invitation is going to be a little different this morning. Sorry, you got this one on?
Maybe.
Maybe. today, I know of churches in Kentucky, churches in Florida, churches, excuse me, Washington, churches here in our own association that are going to be praying for us at about this time. And I'm going to ask that we do exactly the same thing. The invitation is going to be Sweet Hour of Prayer. That's another one of the things I changed as soon as Jim walked in the door.
I love it, Pastor.
And instead of coming up here with a request, I'm going to ask that you come up here and use these front two pews or so as a place to just come before God and ask God for some things. Charlie, you got them up here yet? The loss of dream. You realize that in this town, there's more lost than there are Christians. There are those who their parents are lost, their grandparents are lost. And I wouldn't be surprised if their great-grandparents were lost. They need Jesus Christ. Christ above Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often would I gather you together as a hen does her chicks, but you would not. Yes, and he wept. He wept over the loss. He prayed over the loss. The personnel needs of the church. There's a lot of different offices that need filled, and we just don't have the people to fill it. So I would say that's another thing we need to pray for. The church. There's so many things that we could list into that area. Such a vast area. But you heard what I said earlier about the lost needing to come to Christ. Coming to know it. The heart of the lost, the heart for the lost, rather, in the church. And God to work in this area. Pastor, a friend of mine, years and years ago, said, you want to know how to be successful in your ministry? Be where God's working. It's really that simple. Be where God's working. And I would ask this, that we would ask God to pour out His Spirit on this area, that there would be a mass revival in this area, that God would just focus on grain, and that people would come to know Him. I don't know what that would take. Right now, I don't really care what that would take. I would say, God, use any means that you have at your disposal. And you know what that means? He has everything at His disposal. That God would just focus on rain. Now there's a lot of other things that we could pray for. And don't get me wrong, there's a lot of other good things that we can pray for. But these are the ones I would ask us just to come up here and pray. If we have the
I think so.
Okay. I'm going to ask you to stand. I'm not going to ask you to sing. Jim and I will be taking care of that aspect of things. I don't do this very often. Sweet Hour.
Thank you.
in seasons of distress and grief. My soul has often found relief and oft escaped the tempter's snare. By thy return, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer, may I thy consolation say, from mountain sweet lofty height, I view my home and take my flight. This robe of flesh shall drop and rise, it sees the everlasting prize, and shall dwell passing through the air. Farewell, farewell, sweet hour of prayer.
Shall we turn it off? JJ was pushing too many buttons back there.
She missed slides.
Have that ability. Lord, we ask these things.